Hello students, welcome to this video series. In this video series, I am going to explain all the questions of Isro 2008 computer science. So we will see the solutions of each and every question of this paper one by one. So first question says, which of the following is an illegal array definition? Okay, illegal array definition. We have to find which of the declaration is illegal. Okay. So as you can see, this is nothing but the Pascal declaration of array. Okay, Pascal declaration. So in Pascal, this is the declaration of Pascal. Okay, in Pascal programming language, how we declare the array. So in this Pascal's declaration, array declaration is like this: array identifier. This is the syntax to declare an array in the Pascal, and the array keyword. So array is a keyword in the Pascal, and this index type. Okay, index type. After that, of elements. Okay, this is the declaration in the Pascal language. So array identifier is nothing but the name of the array. Okay, name of array. And this index type is important. This can be of any scalar type, except real. Okay, we cannot have index type as real. So real cannot be there in the index type. So array can be like this. For example, you can declare the array in the Pascal language like this: vector. This is the name of the array, vector array. 1 to 25, okay, Pascal array. Okay, it is like this. Pascal equals to array. Okay, array is a keyword. Then the index type, this is integer type of real. Okay, of real. So we have an array which is a type of real, and the index of array are 1 to 25. So we have an array of 25 elements which are of type real, and the name of the array is vector. So that's how we declare the array in the Pascal language. So first one says type calling lime, pine, musk and menthol. This is the, this is like an enumeration. Okay, we are taking a new data type. We are actually creating a new data type and then taking the array of that type. Okay, column type. So we have created a column type, and then we have declared an array A of column of real type. Okay, so this is valid. Variable A, array real. So as I said, we cannot have an array index type as a real. So anything can be here, but except real. So this is the array of character. This is allowed in Pascal language. This is the type of, this is the array, variable A. The name of the array is A, and the type of the array is character type of real. Okay, so we can have like this. Boolean type we can have, but we cannot have an array like this. So this is illegal in the Pascal language. So this is illegal. So answer for this question is B, because this question asking about the illegal array declaration. So this question is asking the subnet mask. We have given a subnet mask that is of 255. .255.255. This is the net mask of class C. .192. So .192 is nothing but 11000000. So like this. So in subnet, in net mask, what we do is we take the net bits, net ID bits, and make them one. So as you can see in this, in the class C, this is the mask of class C. Okay, this is a class C mask. In class C, we have a net ID of 24 bits. Net ID is of 24 bits. So what we have done is, in, we have make a subnet of class C. In, from the class C, we have made a subnet in which we have taken 2 bits from the host part. From the host part. So according to this, this is the net mask of the class C. Okay, because the net ID in class C is 24 bits, and when we create a mask, we take the net bit, net ID bits all ones. Okay, these are all ones. 24 bits are ones. And we have borrowed 2 bits from the host part, which means now your net ID becomes of 26 bits. Okay, net ID becomes of 26 bits because we have extended the class C net mask. Okay, so extend the next portion of, extends the network portion of to 26 bits. So this is the right answer for this question. What we are doing is we are extending our net ID of 24 bit to to 26 bits because we have taken 2 bits from the host part. In subnetting, what we do is we create the subnetworks from a network by taking the bits from the host part. So answer to this question is B. So this question says, on a LAN, where are IP datagrams transported? Okay, which means how we transport the IP datagrams. For example, if you see the layering of OSI model, here we have transport layer. And on transport layer, we use segments. Okay, we use segments. So in network layer, what we do is we divide this segment into packets. And then the segment data is added to here. So this segment will be divided into packets like this. And with each packet, we will have header. Okay, we will have header. So like this, the segment data is transported in the IP packet. In the IP packet, as you can see, the segment data, this data will be segment data, and we will add a header with the packet. So we divide the segment into packets, and with each packet, we add a header. So this is IP datagram, IP packet, or you can say this is IP packet. This will go to the data link layer. Now data link layer will divide this packet into frames. Okay, on data link layer, we will divide the packet into frames, and this is network layer and this is transport layer. So what we do is in data link layer, we divide the packet into frames, and the IP packets are working as a data in the frame. Okay, complete header, header plus data. Header plus data is divided into frames. So this complete packet, the portion of this packet will go as a data part to frames, and we will add a header. In this, we will add physical address in the header of frame. So like this, as you can see, this IP packet is working as a data for frames, and then we are adding a header. So this question is saying, in LAN, where are IP datagrams transported? In the LAN header, in the application field, in the information field of the LAN frame. So if you see in the LAN header, this is incorrect. LAN means we are talking about data link layer, but in data link layer header, we are not adding data. This is saying you are adding this, you are taking this IP header and adding this into IP head, into LAN header or data link layer header. This is false. In the application field, no. In the information field of the LAN frame, yes, this is the information field of the LAN frame in which we are taking IP packet as a data and then adding a header. So C is the right answer for this question. Next question says, which of the following transmission media is not readily suitable for CSMA operation? Okay, CSMA operation means carrier sense multiple access. Which of these we cannot sense? Okay, can you sense radio signal or you can say wireless signal? No, wireless transceiver are half duplex. Okay, wireless transceiver are half duplex. So in wireless transmission, either you can send or you can receive. But you cannot actually sense this transmission. Okay, in the wireless transceiver, wireless transmission, you cannot sense the media because either you are sending or you are receiving. Okay, at a time, either you are receiving or you are sending like this, but you cannot do both operations simultaneously. Okay, you cannot send and receive simultaneously, which means you cannot detect you cannot sense the medium. Okay, you cannot sense the wireless medium, but you can sense the wired medium. So due to this, option A is the right answer. This question says the TCP sliding window. TCP sliding window means we are providing this sliding window in TCP layer is used to provide the flow control. Okay, to provide the flow control. Just like in the data link layer, we provide the flow control with the sliding window protocol. Okay, so this TCP sliding window is used to control the flow of information. Always occur when the field is zero? No. These three options are nowhere related to this question. Only A is the right answer. Can be used to control the flow of information. Flow control is provided by TCP layer and the data link layer as well. So data link layer provides the flow control locally and TCP layer provides the data flow control point to point. Okay, this is the difference between TCP flow control and data link layer flow control. So sliding window is used to just to control the flow between sender and receiver. So A is the right answer for this question. So this question says, what is the bandwidth of the signal that range from 40 kHz to 4 MHz? Okay, 40 kHz to 4 MHz, which means this is asking about the bandwidth. What is the meaning of bandwidth? If in computer science, if you talk about the bandwidth, in computer science, bandwidth is nothing but amount of data amount of data that can be transferred from one location to another, in a given time frame. This is the definition of bandwidth in computer science. Okay, so for example, bandwidth is like this, 100 MB per second, which means you can transfer 100 MB in 1 second. This is the bandwidth in computer science. If you talk about the bandwidth in terms of electronics, in electronics we define the bandwidth like this. Bandwidth refers to difference between the highest frequency signal and lowest frequency signal component. Okay, so this is the definition of electronics. So this question is simply asking in terms of electronics. So if you say about the signal, signal will be like this. Okay, let's say this is the signal and this is the lowest bandwidth F1 and this is the highest bandwidth F2. Okay, this is the peak. Okay, this is the peak of the signal and this is known as the bandwidth. Okay, let's say F2. So bandwidth is nothing but the difference between these two points, highest signal, this is highest frequency and lowest frequency. So bandwidth is nothing but the difference between highest frequency and lowest frequency. This is given, highest frequency is 4 megahertz and lowest frequency is 40 kilohertz. So you can write them in one form, that is, let's say we write this in kilohertz. So if you write this in kilohertz, you can say like this. Or you can write this in megahertz. Okay, let's convert this 40 kilohertz into megahertz. To convert 40 kilohertz to megahertz, we have to divide by 1000. Okay, so this will become 0.040. So difference will be like this, 4 minus 0.40 megahertz. Okay, because now this is also megahertz, this is megahertz. 4 megahertz minus 0.040 megahertz equals to 3.96. Okay, this will be the bandwidth of this signal. Okay, so that is C is the right answer for this question. Which project under 802 standard provides for a collision free protocol? Okay, collision free protocol. So what we mean by collision free protocol, which means, this means that we do not need any protocol for collision detection or carrier sense. Okay, collision free protocol. What is 802? 802 is a family of IEEE standards, and this is for a specific purpose. Okay, the specific purpose is they deal with LAN and MAN. Okay, so this means that this protocol is on the data link layer. Okay, LAN and MAN. For example, 802.1 is used for bridges. 802.2 is used for LLC, that is logical layer control, and 802.3 is used for Ethernet. And we know that Ethernet is not a collision free protocol and it uses CSMA CD to detect collision. Okay, then 802.4 is used for token bus, and 802.5 is used for token ring. And token ring and token bus, these two are collision free protocols. Okay, collision free because we use the concept of tokens for data transmission. For example, two nodes cannot transmit in this topology, in the token ring network. In token ring LAN, two nodes cannot transfer simultaneously. Why? Because we have token. Any node which is having the token will only transfer. Only one node will have token at one time. So only that node will be transmitting. Others will be listening. So we do not have any possibility of the collision in the token ring protocol. So 8025, that is token ring protocol, and this is collision free protocol because we do not need any another protocol, any separate protocol for collision detection. So this is collision free protocol 802.5. This question says the Boolean theorem AB plus A bar C plus BC equals to AB plus A bar C. Okay, so this is saying we have something like this AB plus A bar C plus BC equals to AB plus A bar C. This is nothing but there is a theorem in Boolean algebra. This theorem is known as Constant's theorem. According to Constant's theorem, this can be written as this. Okay, how we can omit BC? Why we can omit BC? Because this is redundant. Why this is redundant? For example, let's say in this A equals to 0. Okay, if I put A equals to 0, this will become 0 into B plus A is 0, then A bar will be 1. So 1 into C plus BC, and this will become 0 into B plus this will be 1 into C. So as you can see, this becomes 0, this becomes C and plus BC. C plus BC equals to this will become C. So this is nothing but C. Okay, they are equivalent. They are equivalent. So this BC is redundant. Even without this BC, I can have C, because if I remove this BC, I will have C through this. Okay, so this will be equal to this. If I put A equals to 1, as you can see, this is Boolean variable. A is a Boolean variable, so value can be 0 or 1. If I put A equals to 1, if the theorem is true, then this can be used, which means this will become, this is 1 into B plus A bar will become 0 because A equals to 1, so A bar will become 0. This will become 0 dot C plus BC equals to A is 1 into B plus 0 into C. Okay, so this will become B plus BC, or you can say this will become B. Okay, 1 into B is 1, 1 into B is B, and this is 0. So this will become B. So I will say this is 1 plus C equals to B, and this is B equals to B. So this theorem is true according to the two values of 0 and 1. So I can have B without this term. Okay, without this term I will have B. So B equals to B. This term is this redundant. So I can say AB plus A bar C plus BC equals to AB plus A bar C. And let's see what are these. Okay, what options are saying? These options are saying nothing but the dual of this. Dual means, what we mean by dual? Dual means OR operation is replaced with the AND operation, and true are represented with false, true are replaced with false, and false are replaced with true, and we do not touch complement or uncomplemented variables. Okay, they will remain as it is. Do not touch complements. So if I take the dual of these values, it will become like this. Okay, this will become like this. OR and will be replaced with OR, so this will become A plus B. Now this OR will be replaced with AND, and A bar, this AND will be replaced with OR, this OR will be replaced with AND, and then this AND will be replaced with OR, that is B plus C, and this will become A plus B and A bar OR C. Okay, so this whole term will, after taking the dual of this term, it will become like this. So option A is matching. A is the right answer for this question. So in this question we have some combination of AND and OR gates. Okay, this is AND gate and this is OR gate. Like this we have connected AND and OR gates in serial manner. So what will be the expression? Okay, x0 x1. So at this output line, this will be AND of x0 x1, that means it will become x0 x1, and then we will OR x0 x1 with x2. So OR will add these two terms, x0 x1 plus x2. So if I give this x0 x1, this will be the output here at this position. Now I have to apply the AND between this term and this term x3. This AND will do between these two ends. So this will become x3 and x0 x1 plus x2. Like this I will give this to next OR gate. OR gate will have like this x4, and we will have a OR gate like this. So if I give this as an input, this will become x3 x0 x1 plus x2 or x4. So like this term will become like this, x3, x0, x1, x3 plus x2, x3 plus x4. Like this, their term will be increasing. So if you look at the options, we do not have any pattern like this. Okay, all the options are not giving any pattern like this because x0, x1, x3 is mandatory. If you can see from this, x0, x1, x3 is mandatory and we do not have any term like this, x0, x1, x3. Okay, so none of the options are matching, but the right answer is like this. Next question says, if we have n square equals to 7601 base 8, where n is a positive integer, then the value of n is what? So we have something like this, n square equals to 7601 base 8, and n is a positive integer, which means n is in decimal. So what I can do is I can convert this number into decimal, and n square equals to, this will become 7 into 8 to the power 3 plus 6 into 8 to the power 2. This is the that's how we convert any number into decimal, plus 0 into 8 to the power 1 plus 1 into 8 to the power 0. So the answer to this will be like this. It will be 3969 if you add up all these terms. So n square equals to 3969 in decimal. So now what you can do is you can say n equals to under root of 3969, and the under root of 3969 will be 63. Okay, so n is 63. So what is the equivalent of this? This number is decimal, but the options are giving in another base. So we have to convert 63 into another base. So let's convert into 5. If we want to convert decimal number into another base, what we need to do is we need to take the division method by the base. So if I take 5, if I take by base 5, then the value should come 241. So this will be 3, 2, okay, so the conversion of this number in the base 5 will be 223 base 5. So this is false. If I take the conversion in the 6 base, okay, base 6, this will become 6. This will be 3 and then 4. So the conversion will be like this, 143 base 6, which is okay. Okay, B is the right answer for this question. If you take the base 6 conversion of this decimal number, it will be in the form of 143 base 6. Next question says, assume that each character code consists of 8 bits. So we have a character of 8 bits. The number of characters that can be transmitted per second through an asynchronous serial line. Asynchronous serial line at 2400 baud rate and with 2 stop bits. Okay, so what is the bit rate? Okay, how many characters we can transfer through this channel which is having 2400 baud rate? So in serial line transfer, if we have serial line, we can transfer the data in two forms, that is synchronous transfer or in asynchronous mode. So they differ in the way they add the data, they add the redundant bits to the data. In synchronous transfer, what we do is we add 3 characters of 8 bits, 3 8-bit characters with 38-bit data. Okay, with each 38-bit data, we add 3 8-bit characters, or you can say with 30 characters, 30 bytes, we add the 3 bytes. For example, like this, if data is your, we will add 3 bytes, like this, synchronization 1, synchronization 2, and synchronization 3. Like this, and then we will have data. So with each with the data, we add 3 characters, and data is of 38-bit characters. Okay, with 30 bytes, or you can say with 30 characters, we add 3 redundant characters, and when the data reaches to receiver, receiver discards these 3 characters. Okay, receiver will discard these 3 characters which are added as a redundant to provide the synchronization. So this is the difference between synchronous and asynchronous. In asynchronous transfer, receiver does not discard the redundant bits. Okay, for example, if you take the example of this, we can say like this. Let us frame a question on synchronous serial transfer, then you will understand. I have a question that is, calculate the data rate. calculate the data rate at which the receiver is taking data if bit rate of channel is okay. What is the difference between bit rate and baud rate? Baud rate means number of characters transferred. In this, number of bits transfer, one character will have several bits. So number bit rate of channel is, if the bit rate of the channel is 1200 bits per second, 1200 bits per second. Okay, so what is the data rate at which receiver is sending? Receiver is receiving. Okay, channel is able to transfer 1200 bits per second, but at what speed the receiver is receiving? As we are saying, receiver is receiving this data and receiver is discarding these three characters, these three redundant bytes, or you can say. So from this you can say 3 8-bit synchronization bit are added with 38-bit characters. Okay, 38-bit characters. With 38-bit characters, or you can say with 240 bits, we add 24 bits. Okay, these are the three characters which are added with 30 characters. Okay, they are of 8-bit. Okay, 8-bit synchronization characters. Okay, we use these three characters for the synchronization purpose. So you can say 24 bits, which are synchronization bits, are used to transfer 240 data bits. Okay, 240 data bits. Or you can say for one data bit, we require 24 divided by 240 bits, 24 synchronization bits. Okay, because 24 synchronization bits are required to transfer 240 data bits. Okay, and this is saying we have a bit rate of 1200 bits per second. So to transfer 1200 bits, how many synchronization bits are required? For one bit, we require this much of synchronization bits. For 1200 bits, we will require this much of synchronization bits. Okay, which means this will become 120. Okay. 120 synchronization bits are required to transfer 1200 bits. Okay, so what receiver will do? Receiver will discard these 120 bits because they are synchronization bits. So out of 1200 bits, 120 are synchronization bits. So you can subtract them and this will become 1080 data bits. Or you can convert this into characters. Okay, 1080, and each character is of 8 bits. So you can say it will be 135 characters per second. So receiver is receiving the data at this rate. Okay, receiver is receiving the data at this rate, or you can say 1080 bits per second. Sender is sending the data at 1200 bits, but receiver is receiving at this speed, because these first three characters are for synchronization. Let's talk about the asynchronous data transfer, because the question is on asynchronous serial transfer. So this asynchronous transfer differs in one way. Okay, what is that one way? Asynchronous serial transfer is like this. Asynchronous serial transfer. In asynchronous serial transfer, what we do is we add one start bit. Okay, we add one start bit. Start bit is only one bit. Okay, then we have one character. With each character, this is data. With the data in starting, we will add a start bit, then we add a parity bit. Okay, parity bit is also one bit. Okay, one bit, and this is optional. This is optional. And then we add two stop bits. Okay, we have stop bits. Stop bits can be one or more, but in the question it is given two stop bits. So we are using two stop bits. So it is not specified about parity bits, so we are not taking parity bits, but these start bit and stop bits are mandatory. These are mandatory. Okay, we have to add these. So one character is of 8 bits. This is being said in this question. Code consists of 8 bits. The character is of 8 bits. So we have one start bit, 8 character bits, and then two stop bits. So one character becomes of 11 bits. Okay, after adding the redundant bit in the data, one character becomes of 11 bits. Okay, one character becomes of 11 bits, and your line is able to transfer 2400 bits, 2400 characters per second. Okay, baud rate is this. Baud rate means 2400 characters per second. Okay, if this was bit rate means 2400 bits per second. So this is the difference between baud rate and bit rate. So one character is of 11 bits, and you can transfer 2400 characters. So number of characters you can transfer in 1 second is like this. So this will become 218 point something. Okay, so you can take it 218. So 218 characters can be transferred through this line if one character is having 8 data bits, 1 start bit and 2 stop bits. So one character becomes of 11 bits. Remember, byte and characters are different things. Byte means 8 bits, but the character will be of more than 8 bits or maybe of 8 bits. So the size of the character is not fixed. It will be given in the question. So the number of characters you can transfer is 218. This question is simple. This is saying four jobs to be executed on a single processor system arrive at time 0 in the order A, B, C and D. Okay, burst time, these are the processes A, B, C and D. We are using C, burst time used by these processes are 4181 time units. The completion time of A, when we are using round robin scheduling algorithm with the time slice of 1 unit. Okay, time quanta is 1 unit, 1 time unit. So these processes are like this. We have four processes, that is, we have process, arrival time and burst time. So we have four processes A, B, C and D. Arrival time of these processes are 0 and burst time is 4181. So time quantum for round robin algorithm is 1, it is given. So it is asking the completion time of A, process A. So if you draw the Gantt chart, you will see that from 0 to 1, process A is running, then time quantum expires, there will be interrupt, and then B will come. B will exit from 1 to 2. So each process will run only for 1 time unit because the time quantum is 1. Then process B is completed because it requires only 1 time unit. Then C will come and it will execute from 2 to 3. Then D will come, it will execute from 3 to 4. So D is also completed because it requires only 1 time unit. Okay, these two processes are completed and we have executed 1 of this process and 1 time unit of this process. So only two processes are left, A and C. So they will alternate between each other. A will execute, it will become 5, then C will execute, it will come to 6. Okay, so we have executed one more time. This requires 2 time units, this requires 6 time units. Then A will execute from 6 to 7. Now only 1 time unit is required for process A. Then C will execute from 7 to 8. This requires 5 time units now. Okay, so now 8 to 9 process A will run and time process A completes. Okay, A is completed at this point. That is time 9 time units. Now only one process is there in the queue, that is C. So now we will start executing C and C will execute from 9 to 14. Okay. So C will keep executing like this for 5 times. So it will execute from 9 to 14. That is 5 more time units. So C completes here. A completes at this point. B completes at this point. D completes at this point. So completion time of B is 2. Completion time of D is 4. Completion time of A is 9. And completion time of C is 14. So this question is asking about the completion time of A. The completion time of A is 9. Which of the following algorithm design technique is used to in finding all pair shortest path? Okay, all pair of shortest path distance in a graph. So for all pair shortest path, we use an algorithm that is known as all pair shortest path or distance, you can say. For this purpose, we use an algorithm that is Floyd-Warshall algorithm. Floyd-Warshall algorithm, and this algorithm uses the dynamic approach, dynamic programming approach. Okay, So for finding the oil pair shortest path, we use the dynamic approach. That is, option A is the right answer for this question. This question says, the address space of 8086 CPU is what? So this question is from microprocessor, and in this we have two processors, that is 8085 and 8086. The difference is, in 8086 we use a data bus of 16 bits. Okay, so word size is 2 bytes. And address bus is of 20 bits. So there are 20 lines in the 8086 processor for addresses and 16 lines for data. So we use these some of the bits are used for the same purpose. They are multiplexed bits, which means some of the lines, some of the pins in the 8086 processor are used for both. That is data bus and address bus, or you can say data pins and address pins. So if the address pin is of 20 bits, you can have a memory of 2 to the power 20 bytes. You can address 2 to the power 20 bytes with the 20 bits address. So this is nothing but 1 MB. So 1 MB memory is available in 8086, which is divided into multiple segments. Okay, stack segment, code segment, data segment, extra segment, like this. This memory is divided into segments. So the memory available in 8085, 8086 microprocessor is 1 megabytes. This question says, more than one word are put in one cache block to exploit the temporal locality of reference or exploit the spatial locality of reference in a program, reduce the miss penalty, none of the above. So if we have, like, this is a cache, and cache is divided into blocks. Okay, cache is divided like into blocks, and memory is divided into words. This is your memory, and this is divided into words. Okay, this is the word size. Word or byte, it depends. Memory is word addressable or byte addressable. If the memory is byte addressable, then the one address is given to each byte. If the memory is word addressable, then for few bytes we will give one word, one address. So this is main memory and this is cache memory, and the transfer unit between cache memory and word and the main memory is in the size of blocks. Okay, so for example, one block size is, let's say, 4 words. So what we do is, whenever there is a miss in the cache, we take the 4 words from the memory and transfer them into the one cache block. Why? Because it is possible that whenever any CPU is accessing the word number 0, it is possible that it will access word number 1, word number 2 and word number 3 also. So this is known as spatial locality. Spatial locality is related to space. Okay, spatial related to space, and temporal locality is related to time. What we mean by space and time? Whenever temporal locality says, if you are accessing a word number 0 at this time, let's say time equals to t0, you are accessing the word number 0. It is possible that at time equals to 1, you will access the same word. You will access the same word. This is the definition of temporal locality. According to spatial locality, we say that if you are accessing the word number 0, then it is possible that in future you will access the word number 1 also, and word number 2 also, and word number 3 also. This will depend on the size of the cache block. So what we do is, we, instead of taking a single word from the main memory when there is a miss in the cache, we take the 4 words from the main memory to cache. For example, block size of 4 words. So 4 words will be taken from the memory and will be put it into one cache block. So next time when CPU want to access word number 1, it does not need to go to the main memory, it will be accessed from the cache memory. So this is the meaning of spatial locality. So answer to this question is B, that is, exploit the spatial locality of reference in a program. We keep more than one word in a single cache block to exploit the spatial locality of reference. This question says, the performance of a pipeline processor suffers if which of the following reasons? First one is, the pipeline stages have different delays. Consecutive instructions are dependent on each other. The pipelining stages share hardware resources. Okay, for example, let's say what it means is, instruction fetch is having the 40 nanosecond delay. Okay, the pipeline stages have different delays. Instruction decode is having 30 nanosecond delay. Let's say execution stage is having 20 nanoseconds. And let's say write back stage is having the delay of 25 nanoseconds. So if all the stages are having the different delays, then it will affect the performance of the pipelining. Okay, it will affect the performance of pipelining because the shorter stages will be waiting for the longer stages. For example, instruction phase takes 40 nanoseconds, then next instruction have to wait because next instruction want to fetch an instruction, but this current stage is not completed yet. Okay, for example, instruction decode will wait for this instruction fetch, execution will wait for instruction decode because all the stages are in the serial manner. After instruction fetch, we will do instruction decode. After instruction decode, we will do execution. After execution, we will do write back. So if they have same delays, then there is no problem. But if they have different delays, there is a problem. So this will lead to the decrement in the performance of the pipelining. Consecutive instructions are dependent on each other. Okay, if the instructions are dependent on each other, this will actually help to decrement the process, the performance of pipelining. The pipelining stages share the hardware resources. That is definitely will decrease the performance of the pipelining because if let's say for example instruction fetch want to use main memory and the write back stage also want to use main memory. So there is a conflict. This is the resource conflict. This is the problem in the pipelining. Okay, so this will decrease the performance of pipelining, which means all of the above reasons are there, which will decrease the performance of pipelining. Next question says, if 1 to x below, base 3 equals to 1 to 3 base x, then the value of x is what? Okay, if you look at this question carefully, there is no need to solve this question and you can directly say option is D. Why? If you have any base like let's say 8, that means you can have values in this, in number can be from 1 to 7. You can compose any number in this by using the digits 1 to 7, but you cannot use 8. So number digits used inside this number will be 1 to 7. For example, if the base is 10, you can use the digits from 0 to 9, okay, 0 to 7. And if the base is let's say 6, you can use the numbers, you can use the digits from 0 to 5, but not 6. So this is simply saying 1 to x base 3, if the base is 3, then the value of x should be less than 3. Okay, this is saying value of x should be less than 3. Okay, this is saying value of x should be less than 3 because the base is 3. So values in here will be, the digits you can use in here will be less than 3. So this can be either 0 or 1 or 2. Now this is saying 1 to 3 base x. Okay. This is saying 1, 2, 3 base x, which means if the base is x, okay, if the we have used 3 inside this number, we have used 3 to form the number, 3 digit is used, which means x should be greater than 3. Okay, this is saying x should be greater than 3. Okay, let's say base can be 4, but base cannot be 3 because as I said, the digit can be used inside this will be less than the base, will be less than the base. But this is saying we have used 3 in here, so base will be greater than 3. Base cannot be 3, base can be only 4, 5, 6, 7, anything, but cannot be 3. So this is saying this is saying the value of x should be less than 3, and this is saying the value of x should be greater than 3. So there is a contradiction. This means that none of the options are matching. This question says, how many 2 input multiplexers are required to construct a 2 to the power 10 input multiplexers? Okay, this is simply saying you want to construct 2 to the power 10 to 1 multiplexer using 2 to 1 multiplexer. Okay, so multiplexer is always n to 1 like this. Okay, so this is nothing but 10242 1. Okay, so you have to construct a 10241 multiplexer using 2 to 1 multiplexer. How we can do that? We have to provide 1024 input lines. Okay, and one multiplexer is providing only 2 input lines. This is 2 to 1 mux, which you have to use to construct a 10241 multiplexer. Okay, so this will be giving one input line and 2 inputs line will be there. So to get 1024 input lines, you have to take how many multiplexers? Okay, each multiplexer is giving you 2 input lines and you want 1024 lines. So how many input, how many multiplexers are required at this level? At this level we will require 512 mux. Okay, 512 mux, because 1 mux is giving 2 input lines, 512 mux will give 1024 input lines. So we will have like this. This will be line number 0, this will be line number 1, this will be line number 2, line number 3, this will be line number 1022. This will be line number 1023. Okay, so we will have output lines of these multiplexers. They are 512 multiplexers. This is mux number 0. This is mux number 1. This is mux number 511. Okay, from 0 to 511, we have 512 multiplexers. So but mux is always will give output line 1. So now we have to take this level 1. On level 1, we have 512 mux. So what we'll do is, we will have a mux 2 to 1, and we will use these output lines as the input line to this mux. So 512 mux are giving 512 input lines. Okay, they are giving 512 input lines. 512 mux will give 512 output lines, because each mux will give as one output line. So how many mux are required at this level? At this level, we will require 256 mux. Okay, like this, these input lines will be connected. So two mux will be, one mux will be used to connect two mux. So 512 mux are at this level. We will require at level 2, we require 256 mux. This will be mux 0. This will be mux 255. So 256 mux are required at this level, and they will give output lines, which will be 256 output lines. So we will have 256 output lines at this level, and I have to make output line only one. Okay, there should be only one output line. So at this level, we will use again 2 into 1 mux, which will be provided as the outputs. The outputs to these mux will be using as a input to these mux at level 3. Okay, so we will have like this. How many mux are required at this level? Because we have 256 mux at this level 2, and two lines will, the two mux will give as an input line to 2 into 1 mux. So how many level at the level 3? We require 256 by 2, because each we are combining two multiplexers and giving them as an input to next level mux. So they will be having how many? Like this, at level 3 we will have 128 mux, mux number 0 and mux number 127, because they are 256 output lines, and each mux is taking two input lines. So 256 output lines will be used as a input lines to this next level mux, which means two mux out will give out input to one mux, which means 128 mux are required at this level. Like this, we will keep giving the levels of mux, and we will equal 10 levels. Okay, at the level 10, you will have only one mux, which will be used as a input lines. We will have two mux at this level, level number 9, and the level number 10, we will have only one mux, which will give one output line. Okay, like this, number of mux will keep decreasing at the level are increasing. Okay, as you can see, level 1, we have 1024 mux, 512 mux. At level 2, we have 256 mux. At level 3, we have 128 mux. At level 4, we will have 64 mux. At level 5, we will have 32 mux. At level 6, we will have 16 mux. At level 7, we will have 8 mux. Like this, how many mux are required? We require only 10 levels to construct. 10 levels are required to construct 1024 to 1 mux using 2 to 1 mux. So number of multiplexers required are 256, 512 at level 1, then 256 at level 2, 128 at level 3, then 64 at level 4, 32 at level 5, then 16 at level 4, 8 at level 3, like this, 4, 3, okay, 4, then 2, then 1 mux is required. If you add all these numbers, you will find that the addition of these numbers is 1023. So to construct 1024 to 1 mux, we using 2 to 1 mux, we require 1024 multiplexers, and the levels will be 10. Okay, 10 levels will be there. So 1024 multiplexers, 2 into 1 multiplexers are required to construct a 2 to the power 10 to 1 mux. That is, answer is 1023. This question says, a computer uses 8-bit mantissa and 2-digit exponent. If A is equals to 0.052 and B equals to 28e plus 11. Okay, this is nothing but simply 28 into 10 to the power 11. Okay, this is nothing but this, these two things are equivalent. So we have to, what we need to do is, we need to find the value of b plus a minus b. Okay, you have to find the value of b plus a minus b. So what will be the value of this? Result in an overflow, result in an underflow, zero, or the answer is this. Okay, let's see. A can be written as, if you want to take mantissa, mantissa will be the value, we will have a value, point will be here, which will means it will be 0.52. If you want to take point from here to here, you have to multiply by 10 to the power minus 1. Or this number can be written as 0.52 e minus 1. These two things are same. And b is, b will become, because you have to take mantissa will be the right hand side of the decimal point. Okay, from decimal point, anything to the right hand side is a mantissa. So this can be written as, this is 28 e plus 1 11, or you can say this is 28 into 10 to the power 11. When you take point, okay, point is right at this position now, you have to take point here because mantissa is everything to the right hand side of the point. So this will become 0.28 into 10 to the power 13, or you can say 0.28 e plus 13. Plus 13 means the the exponent is 13 and the value is in plus. Okay, the value is in plus. So what you need to do is, now you need to find b plus a. First we will find b plus a, then we will do minus b. So what will be the b plus a? If you want to add these two numbers, you have to bring the exponent to same level. Okay, this is the exponent to minus 1, this is exponent to plus 13. So if you want to make this to minus 1, what you need to do is, you need to multiply by 10 to the power minus 14. Okay, then this will become 10 to the power minus 1. So to do this, you have to add zeros to the right hand side, which means b will become 28, and you have to add 14 like this. For this will be 28 into 10 to the power 11. If you take this, this will become 28 into 10 to the power 11 if you convert this into this form, and then we have 10 to the power minus 14. Okay, so this will be like this. Okay, you have to take point to the 14 position to the right. Okay, because you are multiplying by 10 to the power minus 14 into 10 to the power minus 1, which means now this number becomes, b becomes 28 e minus 1. Okay, like this, 28. This number will become e minus 1. So now exponents are equal. Now you can add b plus a. Okay, a is 0.52 e minus 1, and b is 28, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9, 10, 11, 12, e minus 1. So after adding, this number will become like this, 28 and 12 times 0.52, and we have exponent, that is minus 1. Okay, exponent is minus 1. So now, as you can see, this number becomes like this, or you can say the number will be, okay, if I take this point to the left hand side, this will become, I have to cross 4, 4 plus 4, 12 and 28. I have to cross 14 bits to the left. Okay, if I am taking the point to the left, that means I will multiply by 10 to the power that much of positions. This will become 0.28 and 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9, 10, 11, 12, and then 5, 2 into 10 to the power 14 into, this is exponent in minus 1, which means 10 to the power minus 1. So this will become 0.28, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9, 10, 11, 12, 5, 2 into 10 to the power 13. Okay, this will become like this. So you have to take the mantissa only of 8 digits. So you have to discard all the bits after 8 digits. So mantissa should be only in 8 digits, like this. Okay, this will be the mantissa, because the mantissa is in 8 digits. So this will become 0.28, 1, 2, 3, 4, and 1, 2. We have 8-digit mantissa. And exponent is 10 to the power 13. So you can write this number like this, 28. You take the point to two position right, and you can subtract the exponent like this. So this will become 28 into 10 to the power 11. Okay, this will become b. So this is b. Now you have to do subtraction of b. B plus a is this. Okay, this is b plus a. B plus a is 28 into 10 to the power 11. Okay, this is nothing but 28 into 10 to the power 11. Now you have to find b plus a minus b, which means you have to subtract b from this. And what is b? B is 28 into 10 to the power 11. This is b plus e minus, you have to subtract b, that is 28 into 10 to the power 11. As you can see, these two numbers are same. So answer is 0. So answer to this question is C, that is 0. Next question says the Boolean expression A plus C bar into B bar plus C bar simplifies to what? You can say this is A B bar plus A C bar plus B bar C bar plus C bar into C bar is C bar. Or you can say this will be like this, a b bar plus, let's take c common. If c bar is common, this will become, okay, take common from these two. This will become a plus 1 plus b bar c bar. So this will become a b bar plus c bar plus b c bar. Now take c bar common from these two terms. This will become a b bar plus c bar common, and this will be 1 plus b. We know that 1 plus b, anything with plus 1 is 1. So this will become a b bar plus c bar, which cannot be further minimized. So a b bar plus c bar is the right answer, that is a. This question says in the expression a bar into a bar plus b bar, by writing the first term as a plus 0, okay, a can be written as a plus 0. The expression is best simplified to what? Let's first simplify this a bar into a bar plus b bar. If you simplify this, this will become a bar plus a bar b bar. Okay, if you take a bar common, this will be 1 plus b bar, which is nothing but 1. Okay, this is a bar. And now this is saying a can be written as a plus 0. Okay, a can be written as a plus 0. Or you can say a bar, or you can say a complement can be written as a plus 0 complement. Okay, so now if I write a complement as a plus 0 complement, this will nothing but a complement 0 complement. So this will become like this. Okay, if I put in place of a bar, I put a plus 0 bar, this will become a plus 0 complement. This means a complement dot 0 complement, that means a complement into 1, which is nothing but a complement, and a complement is not in the options, but the answer is a complement for this question. Now this question says the logic operations of two combinational circuit given in this figure, okay, figure 1 and figure 2, were entirely different or identical or complementary or dual. So what will be the expression for this circuit? X is applied and the Y complement is applied. This bubble is nothing but the complement of Y, and this bubble is nothing but complement. So all the bubbles are complement except these output and input bubbles. Okay, so this is X. Okay, at this input we have x, and this input is y complement. So the OR of x and y complement is here we have, and the complement of output. This is saying OR these and the complement of them. So this is NOR gate, as you can see, and on the NOR gate we are providing the complement of y. So this will be x plus y bar whole bar. This will be applied to this, which means this first input is x to this OR gate, and the second input is x plus y bar whole bar. Okay, so this input is x plus y bar whole bar. Now it will OR these two operations and will apply the complement of complete operation. OR of these two will be x OR x plus y bar complement, and then complete complement, which means this. So if you simplify this, this will become x complement dot OR and x plus y complement complement and complement. So this will become x complement dot x plus y complement, which is nothing but x complement into x plus x complement and y complement. This is 0, this is x complement y complement. Okay, so answer is x complement y complement for this term. For this circuit, the output is x complement, y complement. For this, this will be x, this will be y complement, and the end of these two operations is x, y complement. So the answer for this circuit is x, y complement. They are neither the complement of each other nor the dual of each other. Dual means, what we mean by dual? Dual means replace AND with OR, and replace OR with AND, and replace 0 with 1 and 1 with 0. Do not touch the complements. In complementation, what we do is we complement the complete term. Okay, so they are neither the complement of each other, neither nor the dual of each other, and neither they are entirely identical. They are actually different, entirely different to each other. So the answer for this question is A. They are not identical, they are not complementary to each other, they are not dual of each other. So the A is the right answer for this question. This question says the output of Y, the output at Y of the given circuit is what? So we are applying 0 as input to these XOR gates. These are the XOR gates. XOR gates. So these two inputs to XOR gate is 0. Okay, this input is 0 and the same input is applied to this 0, 0. 0 XOR is 0 is always 0. Okay, so as you know the table of XOR, 0 XOR 0 is 0. 0 XOR 1 is 1. Whenever the inputs are different, the answer is 1. And whenever the inputs are same, in output is 0. Inputs are same, output is 0. Inputs are different, output is 1. So here, this 0 is applied to all the circuits. And the output of this circuit is 0. And the input to this second line is 0. 0 XOR 0 is 0. Again, 0 is applied to this XOR gate. And second input which is coming is 0. 0 XOR 0 is also 0. So the answer to this question is 0. That is B. This question is simple. This is saying which of the following is not a valid rule in the XOR. So if you see the table of XOR, XOR table is like this. If we have two input XOR, let's say X and Y are two inputs, and this is the output F, which is the XOR of these two. Okay, if the inputs are 0, 0, the XOR of these two is 0. If the input is 0, 1, the output is 1. If the input is 1, 0, output is 1. If the input is 1, 1, the output is 0. Whenever the inputs are different, the answer is 1. If the inputs are same, the answer is 0. Okay, this is the table for XOR gate. 0 XOR 0 is 0. This is true. 1 XOR 1 is actually 0. This is false. 1 XOR 0 is 1. This is okay. B XOR B is 0. This is okay. If the inputs are same, answer is 0. So the correct answer for this question is B. This is asking for the not a valid rule. Not a valid rule. Okay. So B is not a valid rule because 1 XOR 1 is 0. It is given 1. This question is saying the number of distinct simple graphs. Okay, distinct simple graph. Simple graph means no self loop and no parallel edge. Simple graph is, the meaning of simple graph is this. So you cannot have self loop and parallel edges in a simple graph, and it is asking about the distinct simple graph. Each and every word has some meaning in this question. With up to. Okay, up to means the graph can have 0 edge, 1 edge, 2 edge and 3 edge, up to 3 edges, up to 3 nodes, sorry, up to 3 nodes. So we have to check for each node. For example, first we have to check for 0 nodes. Okay, 0 nodes is not a graph. We have to have at least one node. This is one node. With one node, we can have only one graph. This is the one graph, G1, let's say. Let's say then for two nodes. With two nodes, we can have two graphs. One is graph, that is disconnected graph, and we do not have any edge between these two nodes. This is the one graph for with node 2, two nodes, and then we can have one more graph with two nodes when they are connected to each other. We have an edge between these two nodes. Okay, either we can have an edge between these two nodes or we cannot have an edge between these two nodes. A simple graph can be disconnected graph. This is okay. This is disconnected graph. There are two nodes in this graph G2 and we have there is no edge between these two nodes. This is graph G3 with two vertices. Okay, with two vertices we can have two graphs. With one vertex we have only one graph. Then let's say what will be the number of graphs with three vertices. Okay, these are the three vertices. Let's say these are the three vertices, and the vertices are unlabeled. Okay, this is not given. If it is given that vertices are labeled, then you have to add the labels. If with the labels vertices, we will have different graphs. But with this, we can have this graph. This is disconnected graph with three vertices. Three vertices, we can have this graph, or we can have one more graph, that is when two vertices are connected to each other. Okay, with only one edge in the graph. If you take a graph in which you have, let's say, like this. This is one graph, and this is, okay, this is with three vertices, this is one graph, and with these three vertices, you have another graph like this. These two graphs are actually same. They are not a different graph because the vertices are unlabeled. We do not have any labels. So any graph with one edge with three vertices, they are same. Okay. So graph this or this or this will be same. If you take one edge between these two and no edge between these two, no edge between these two, or you take any with, you can connect this edge with any of the vertices. This will be simple as single graph. We will count this graph only at once. Then we will have a graph with two vertices, two edges. Okay, with two edges, you can have graphs like this. This will be a graph with two edges. Okay, two edges can be anywhere. They will be the same graph. That will be counted only once. Okay, this is G6. Then we can have one more graph. That is, let's say, in which we have three vertices. Okay, this is one graph. Let's say this is G7. So with up to three vertices, okay. With up to three nodes, okay. With up to three nodes or three vertices, we can have seven graphs. Okay, seven graphs are possible. With up to, okay, this word is important. Up to. Up to means you can have one vertex, two vertex or three vertex. How many graphs are possible with one vertex, with two vertex and with three vertex? With one vertex we have only one graph, with two vertices we have two graphs, with three vertices we have four, we have three graphs. Okay, like this, this 1 2 3 4. Okay, we have four graphs with three vertices. So 4 plus 2 plus 1, that is seven graphs are possible with up to three nodes. This question says the maximum number of edges in a n node undirected graph without self loops. Okay, so this is asking about the simple graph. So how many edges are possible in a simple graph? In simple graph, as we know that each maximum number of, okay, maximum number means each vertex may be connected to n minus 1 other vertices. Okay, and this vertex cannot be connected to itself. We cannot have an edge with itself because it is asking about the self loop. No self loop, without self loop. So n vertices, one vertex can be connected to n minus 1 vertices. Okay, one vertex may be connected to n minus 1 vertices. So each vertex will be having degree n minus 1. So for each vertex we have degree n minus 1. Okay, like this, for each vertex we will have degree n minus 1 for the maximum number of edges. So if you count the number of the degree of this graph, the degree of the graph will be n into n minus 1. Okay, that will be equal to 2 into edges, because each edge is counted twice. If you are taking the this graph, let's say this is the graph A, B, C. What is the degree of A? The degree of A is 2. What is the degree of B? Degree of B is 2. What is the degree of C? Degree of C is 1. Okay, there are two, the sum of degrees, if you take the sum of degrees of all the vertices, they are 5. Okay, but the number of edges are 2. Okay, for B it is 1. The degree is 1 for B. So number of, the sum of degrees is 4. But each edge is counted for two vertices. Okay, the degree is counted for A by adding these two edges. For B, it is counted in degree. So each vertex, each edge is counted in the degree of two vertices. That's why we say that sum of degree is equals to 2e. So, or you can say from the handshaking theorem, e equals to n into n minus 1 by 2. So number of edges in a graph, maximum number of edges in a simple graph are n into n minus 1 by 2. 2, that is B. This question says, if two matrices are there, this matrix and this matrix have the same determinant, okay, same determinant, then the value of x is what? If you find the determinant of these two matrices, it will be like this. Let's say this is the determinant 1 0 x, 0 x, 1 and 0 1 x, and the determinant of second matrix, that is x x 0 1 0 x and 0 1 1. What will be the determinant for this matrix? 1 into x square minus 1. Then take this minus 0. This will be plus minus plus, like this. This will be 0. Okay, anything multiplication to 0 is will be 0. So it will be 0 minus 0 plus x. X into 0 into 1 and x into 0. 0 into 1 into x 0 is 0. So this will become 0. And the determinants are equal. So x into, if you take this, this is 0 and this is x. So 0 minus x. Minus 1 into, this will become x. X into 1 is x. 1 into 0 is 0. So x minus 0. And plus 0 into something is 0. This will become x square minus 1. Minus 0 plus 0. Okay, because x into 0 is 0. So this will be x square minus 0. And this will be x into 0 is 0. X into minus x is minus x square, minus 1 into x is minus x, and this is all terms is 0. So from this you can say x square minus 1 plus x square plus x equals to 0. This will be x square 2x square plus x minus 1. You can solve this quadratic equation, that is 2x square plus x minus 1 equals to 0. And it will be like this, 2x square plus 2 minus 1 into x minus 1. You can write like this, 2x square plus 2x minus x minus 1 equals to 0. 2x is common, x plus 1 minus 1 is common, x plus 1 equals to 0. So this will be 2x minus 1 into x plus 1 equals to 0. Or you can say the value of x will be 1 by 2 and minus 1. Okay, so the these will be the two values of this x, or you can say the answer is A, that is 1 by 2. The roots are x equals to 1 by 2 and minus 1. So the determinant is, the value of x is 1 by 2. Next question is, the network 198.78.41 equals to 0. Then this is the net ID given, and this is asking which class to this belongs. Okay, in classless, in classful addressing, class A range is, the range of the class A is 0 to 127. Okay, we will look at the first octet, 0 to 127. In class B, the range is 128 to 191. In class C, the range is 192 to 223. In class D, the range is 224 to 239. And the class E range is 242 to 255. These two class are the multicasting classes. Multicasting and unicasting is not allowed in these two classes, and in these three classes unicasting is allowed. Why unicasting is allowed? Because the IP address is divided into two parts, that is net ID and host ID. If you look at the net ID in this 8-bit net ID and 24 bits host ID, like this, in this they are divided net ID and host ID. So this address belongs to which range? In this range, 192 to 223. So this is network is from class C network. This question is saying, the join operation can be defined as what? So we have a join operation in the SQL, okay, or we have join operation in relational algebra also, and it is defined as like this, R join S. Okay, join operation is a derived operation actually. It is not a basic operation. And this operation is derived from the cross product and the projection operator. Okay, selection operator. Selection operator is this. This is selection operation. This is used for to apply the conditions. On the basis of conditions, we select some data. And we have projection operation. Projection is like this, pi, in which we select the attributes. And cross product is like this. These are the basic operations. Okay, R into S. This is cross product. So they are the basic operation. From these basic operations, this join operation is derived. The definition of joint operation is like this. R join S is, first what we do is, we apply the cross product and then we apply the selection operation. Okay, selection operation on the common attributes of R and S. For example, we have two common attributes B and C. Then the join operation will be like this. R dot B equals to S dot B and R dot C equals to S dot C. If we have two common attributes, for example, let's say R table is like this. In this R table, we have three attributes A, B, C. And then we have a new table, that is S. In S, we have, let's say, four attributes B, C, D, E. So common attributes in these two tables are B and C. Okay, on the basis of B, C, we will apply the join operation. So join operation is nothing but the combination of cross product followed by selection operation. Okay, so option A is saying the Cartesian product of two relation followed by selection. This is okay. Cartesian product of two relation, no. A union of two relations, no. So A is the right answer. The Cartesian product of two relation is the join operation can be defined as Cartesian product followed by selection operation. This question is simple. A square matrix A satisfied this equation. Okay, A transpose A equals to A transpose equals to identity matrix. Okay, if any matrix satisfied this property, then the matrix is orthogonal matrix. Okay, this is the definition of orthogonal matrix. So this question is saying an interrupt in which the external device supplies its address. Okay, external device supplies its address as well as the interrupt request is known as which kind of interrupts. So interrupts are of two types on the basis of address supplied. They are vectored interrupt and non-vectored interrupt. So we have two type of interrupt. So for example, we have an IO device and we have CPU. Okay, so some devices in output or input output, they will interrupt CPU from the interrupt pin. Okay, this will be the interrupt pin. For example, let's say this is INTR, and then CPU acknowledges to interrupt after completion of the execution of current instruction, and it will acknowledge the interrupt. How it will acknowledge the interrupt? It will definitely CPU will execute interrupt service routine. So for each kind of interrupt, we have an interrupt service routine, which is the part of operating system. So we have interrupt service routine, which is always in the memory. Okay, this interrupt service routine is always in the memory. Whenever any device interrupt to CPU, CPU will service this interrupt by executing interrupt service routine. Now the question is where this interrupt service routine is stored in the memory. So we require an address where this interrupt service routine is stored. So in case of vectored interrupt, okay, in this vectored interrupt, the device which is interrupting the CPU will supply the address of the interrupt. Okay, address of interrupt service routine, address of ISR is supplied by interrupting device. Okay, interrupting device. So this is the definition of vectored interrupt. In vectored interrupt, the device which is interrupting the CPU will actually supply its interrupt service routine address. It will say, I'm interrupting you and this is my interrupt service routine. My interrupt service routine is stored on the memory location this. Okay, every type of interrupt will have its own interrupt service routine, which will be executed to service this interrupt. Okay, in case of vectored interrupt, the device which is actually interrupting the CPU will provide the address. But in non-vectored interrupt, the device which is interrupting to CPU will not actually provide the address of the interrupt service routine. It is the responsibility of CPU to find out the address of the interrupt service routine. Okay, so this is saying, this is the definition of vectored interrupt. This question is saying the ability to temporarily halt the CPU and use this time to send information on bus is called what? So in case of DMA, we have two kind of transmission, that is burst mode and then cycle stealing mode. Okay, so in we can transfer the data using DMA in these two modes, burst mode or cycle stringing mode. So okay, what in DMA, DM for what purpose we use DMA? DMA is used to transfer data from disk to memory, and we know that memory disk, the read in the disk is in the form of blocks. We read a complete block from the disk, then transfer this to memory. If you are using the burst mode, then what you will do is you will transfer this complete disk block at once. Okay, one block is transferred at once. Okay, we transfer the one block. Okay, let's say block size is 512 KB. So 512 KB will be read from hard disk and it will be transferred completely to main memory. So when this when DMA is transferring this 512 KB block to memory, the data bus will be the DMA will be having the access of data bus. No one can use the data bus while this block is transferred to main memory in the burst mode. Okay, but sometimes CPU need to use the data bus to actually fetch the instruction from the main memory. Okay, CPU will require data bus. For that purpose, we use the cycle stealing mode. In cycle stealing mode, what we do is first DMA will transfer one byte to memory, then the access of data bus will be given to CPU. So like this, CPU and direct memory access DMA will alternate by in the access of the data bus. So data bus for one byte, for one cycle, data bus will be given to DMA. For next cycle, data bus will be given to CPU. So like this, they are alternating in the cycle, and DMA is stealing the cycle of the CPU. So that is known as CPU stealing mode. Okay, actually the master of the computer is CPU. Okay, of any system, the master is CPU, other devices are slaves. So CPU is having the cycle, DMA is stealing the cycle of the CPU to transfer one byte from disk to main memory. So that is known as cycle stealing mode. Whenever the ability to temporarily halt for one cycle, DMA will halt the CPU and will use this time to send the information on bus. Okay, this mode is called as CPU stealing, cycle stealing mode. This question is saying, relative to the program translated by a compiler, the same program when interpreted runs faster, slower, or at the same speed, or maybe faster or slower. So when, let's say you have a program abc.c, you have two options. Either you can compile this program and keep an exe file after the compilation, and this file can be executed many times. Compile only one time and then execute many times. Okay, you can execute many times this file. You do not need to compile if you are not making any changes to your code. Okay, if the code is same, you do not need to recompile this code. You can use the exe file. Okay, so compiler will compile this code at once, and then you can keep this code in the memory to run. But in case of interpretation, what will happen is ABC will be interpreted by the interpreter. Every time whenever you want to execute this program ABC.c, you have to load interpreter to main memory. Then interpreter will interpret this code and will execute this code using exe file. Okay, interpreter will interpret this code line by line, and then we'll execute this code. So every time you want to execute a code, you have to load interpreter to main memory. Then interpreter will actually interpret this code. Like this process will happen. So in case of compiler, you need to compile the code only once. But in case of interpreter, even if code is not changed, one line is not changed, or any line is not changed in the code, you have to still interpret every time you execute this code. So the process will become slower if you use interpreter in place of compiler. Okay, consider the following assembly language program. After the execution of above program, the content of the accumulator will be what? So we have first instruction, that is MVIA. This is nothing but move immediate value. Okay, MV means move, I means immediate value, to accumulator. A simply means accumulator. Okay, A means accumulator, which means we have accumulator. Let's say this is the accumulator. In this, we are transferring 30 hexadecimal value. Let's convert this number into binary number. So in binary, it will be like this. Okay, so this is accumulator, in which we have initially after execution of this instruction, we will have accumulator in which we have a value like this. Then we have second instruction, that is ACI. What we mean by ACI? ACI nothing but simply add immediate value. Okay, I means immediate, add immediate value to accumulator. ACI means add immediate value to accumulator with carry. With carry. So carry is not specified in here. So what we will do is we will add this 30 hexadecimal value to accumulator. Accumulator value was 00110000. And then we will add 30 more to this value. Okay. If 30 is added to this value, 30 means 00110000 in binary. So finally accumulator will become like this. 0110 and then 0000. This is 30, this is 30, okay, this is 60 in hexadecimal. Okay, this is 30 and this is 30 in hexadecimal. And this is 60 in hexadecimal. As you can see, this is 6, this is 0. Okay, so the answer is correct. This is accumulator value, final after execution of this instruction. Now second instruction is saying XRA. What we mean by XRA? XR is nothing but XOR accumulator with the given operand, okay, with the operand given, XOR accumulator, and the operand is given A, itself accumulator. So what we are doing is we are XORing the accumulator with itself. Okay, if you do the XOR operation, for example, if you XOR anything with itself, the answer will be zero. We know that. Okay, XORing anything with itself will be zero. So this is saying XOR accumulator with accumulator itself. What is the value inside the accumulator? Accumulator value is 0110000. Again, accumulator value is 0110000. So what will be the XOR of A XOR O? XOR, that is accumulator XOR accumulator will be 0 XOR 0 is 0, 0 XOR 0 is 0, 0 XOR 0 is 0, and 0 XOR is 0. 0, 0, 0, 0. So answer will be finally 0. Okay. Now last instruction is pop H. Pop H is nothing but we are popping the value. Okay, pop H says whatever the value pointed by program counter is having, let's say, one address 1000. Whatever is the value in the memory at this location, pop this value from the stack and put this value to register pair HL. Okay, so this is the 8086 architecture. In these are the instructions of 8086 architecture. In 8086 we have register pairs like BC, HL. So this is the register pair HL, which is of 16 bits. H is of 8 bits, L is of 8 bits. So 16 bit register, and the data bus in 8086 of 16 bits, which means data is also of 16 bits. So what you are doing is whatever the value is pointed by program counter. For example, let's say this is main memory in which each word is of 16 bits. Okay, 16 bits. So program, let's say this is the address 1000, which is pointed by program counter. So pop H instruction will read the value from the location 1000, and whatever value is here, for example, let's say we have this 16 bit value here, it will pop this value from the memory and will put this into this register HL. So this question is asking the after the execution of the above program, the content of the accumulator is what? We know that in accumulator we have stored the XOR of accumulator with itself, that is 0. So answer is 00 hexadecimal. This is question is from C, and we have a small function int f int n. This is static int I equals to 1. If n greater than equals to 5, return n. N equals to n plus i plus plus, then return fn and the value of f1. So f1 will be called, which means in n 1 will be stored initially. Then you will execute some statements, and static variable I is a static variable. This means that if you modify I, it will reflect the modification in all the functions. Okay, all the functions will be having the same copy of I. So there will not be a new copy of I will not be created inside the function. So first line is if n greater than equals to 5, return n. But n is 1, so this is false. So first one is false. Let's say this is first statement, this is second, this is third, and this is fourth. Now second statement will be executed, n equals to n plus I. N value is 1 and I value is also 1. So n plus n 1, ni is n plus I is 2. 3 is I plus 1, I plus plus, which means I was 1, now I has become 2. So in this, at this position, I has become 2. And fourth statement will be executed, return f with n. Now value of n is 2, so now f2 will be called. And now we will check first condition, that is if n greater than equals to 5, no. So we will jump to second statement. Second statement says n equals to n plus I. N is 2 and the I is also 2 because the I is static. This is I and the value of I is 2. I is static, which is used by all the functions. Okay, all the functions will use the same copy. So n becomes 4 and I becomes 3 by incrementing by 1. Now calling the function f with the value of n, that is f4 will be called, and f4 will execute the first statement, that is n greater than equals to 5. No, because 4 is not greater than equals to 5, so we will jump to second instruction. Second says n equals to n plus I. N is 4, I is 3. Okay, I value is updated to 3. Now n equals to 4 plus 3. N becomes 7 and I becomes 4. I incremented by 1. Now fourth function is saying call f7. Okay, fourth statement is saying call f7. So f7 will be called and you will reach the first statement. Is 7 greater than equals to 5? Yes, 7 is greater than 5. So you will return n. So this first function will return 7. Return 7 to this function. Then this function will return the 7 to f4. f4 will return the 7 to f2. And f2 will return the 7 to f1. So f1 will finally return 7. That is C is the right answer for this question.